Our next guest are pretty much UK music royalty. The Manic Street Preachers have released their 14th album, Ultra Vivid Lament, earlier this month and getting ready for a UK tour after their longest pause in live performances ever in their career. And they're coming to Manchester. They play the O2 Apollo on the 2nd of October. Earlier, I spoke to James Dean Bradfield, the singer.
It was a month shy of 2 years that we played our last gig. The last gig we played before lockdown was October 2019. We've started gigging. We've done 3 gigs in the last 2 weeks or so, and I've felt very nervous. And, it's been a lack of muscle memory kind of kicking in.
Yeah, but do you get nervous ordinarily anyway, or do you think that's because you've had this gap?
Always get nervous. But the nerves have been of a different kind. I think the nerves in the past have always been like adrenaline. Mm. They've been like the adrenaline just kicking in, and, you know, it just helps you in a way. But these kind of nerves, it's kind of full of doubt. You're 2 years older, you know, I'm 52 years old. It's the first time we've had an enforced break of not playing for that long. And you wonder if the audience are going to be up for it as they used to as well. You have lots of doubt in your head, you know?
I'm sure those doubts will be completely dispersed within moments. No doubt about it.
We shall see.
Yeah, I think so. He's somebody who really enjoys touring. I was listening to an interview with, of course, you know, from past interviews with Charlie Watts, after he passed the other week, and in one of them he was saying, I hated leaving home, I didn't like touring, but they'd start suggesting it, and they'd get, you know, once I got into it, I was all right. Is this something you really look forward to usually, or not?
Going on tour, not only did it mean that you got to play to audiences and you got to see, like, you know, 4,000 or 5,000 people who move and get affected by, you know, the band's music, but also you'd get to cities, you'd go to museums, you'd get to new record shops, you'd find new cafes, you'd get to see different parts of the seaside in Britain. All those things that sound a bit silly, of course, are a real privilege if you're doing it as a job. Mm. But yeah, I loved going away, I loved kind of finding different mountains to go up when you're on tour, whether you be in Edinburgh or whether you be near the Lake District or North Wales or whatever, you know? So kind of all those things are great. It's a real privilege to tour as a musician sometimes. But Charlie Watts also did say, you know, being a professional musician is 75% waiting around and 25% doing things.
That's true. That is what he said. Yeah. Sitting around in the hotel.
Yeah, there is that aspect.
I'm sure they found ways to occupy themselves, as I'm sure you do. People did a lot of stuff in lockdown. I believe you inherited a piano and learnt to play it.
I'm not trying to be corny, but this one behind me, yes. This piano behind me, which she is called Margaret, and I believe she is 103 years old.
Wow.
The Blausner piano from Leipzig in Germany. So, yeah, she came to us just for lockdown, and it kind of felt like a lovely, you know, twist of fate. It felt like serendipity, you know. So lockdown happened, and I looked at this piano, and the little amateur film director in my head started saying to me, this piano was coming here for a reason. You must write songs on the piano instead of the guitar to see if it would give us a new angle. And hopefully it did.
Is it difficult to learn a different? I mean, they say once you've learned one language, it's easier to learn another. Is that the same with instruments?
Yeah. I think so, yeah. I'm never going to be as good as Rachmaninoff or Richard Clayderman. I know what the chords are. You know, I would find all the chords myself because I can translate that from the guitar. Yeah. I sat on my lap and I compared the chords on the guitar to the piano and transferred the chords from the guitar to the piano.
That's brilliant.
Yeah, it does help like that. I'm not very good at learning from books and stuff. I kind of put my own way on things. And like I said, I'm no virtuoso. But it is a very relaxing instrument to play. For me, anyway. For my family, it wasn't that relaxing. trying to learn how to play, but for me...
I got a keyboard for Christmas and learned Twinkle Little Star and played it, and they were all laughing their heads off, so I got no family support whatsoever. Shocking. Why Margaret, by the way? Why that name?
It's after the lady that we got it from.
Oh, brilliant.
So kind of like, it was a kind of, it's a very special part of our family backstory now. You know, we're very proud to have it, and we're very proud that she bequeathed it to us, because she's a lady that's 105 years old.
Wow.
Yes, and that's why she let go of the piano, because she was moving into a care home.
Well, what a special story that is for you know, that it's great when instruments have that kind of history and little life of the and story of their own, isn't it? Do you think the piano's changed the, you know, the melodies that you've come up with now, as obviously it is a totally different instrument. Has it changed things in terms of your writing?
It feels like it led us into a bit more of an ABBA territory sometimes. Mm. There are a few little songs on the record which got these little kind of ABBA-esque flourishes to it. There's more air, there's more oxygen in the melody, and you can hear the words a bit more. Because I play the guitar in the band too, and the guitar is quite an aggressive instrument. And the piano perhaps has a bit more empathy, a bit more sympathy towards the vocal. I think it's let the vocal harmonies shine a bit more.
Mm. It's incredible, isn't it, how even after the unbelievable success you've had and how long you've been doing it, you can still be inspired by new things and new sounds and new avenues to make music.
Yeah, it's lovely. I mean, music is very rewarding, but there is another way of looking at it, that I can't do anything else whatsoever. I'm utterly useless. I'm good at three things: lifting stuff, cooking, and music. So
we've done very, very well at one of them. So I don't know if you're a master chef, but it don't really matter if you're as good at one thing as you are at music. Street Preachers, I mean, just amazing, incredibly successful band, of course, and they've just released their 14th album. They're on the way to perform at the O2 Apollo in Manchester on the 2nd of October. And in this part of the interview with singer James Dean Bradfield, you'll hear him telling me about how they coped with the disappearance of their band member, Richie Edwards, and also speaking about all the gigs that they've done in Manchester and what our city means to them. And of course, it talks about the inspiration as a youngster.
Yeah, it switched on to me when I was about 15 years old. Myself and Nicky Wire, who's the bass player in the band and the lyricist, we were best friends in school, and we had art class together, and there was a guitar in art class. And Nick was already playing guitar, and he taught me my first chord in art class in school. And it was a crazy little thing called love. It's a little D chord.
Ah.
I decided to write songs with each other. And from that age, from 15, I decided I'd be in a band.
That's amazing. Did you have any particular influences that you kind of looked up to, that you wanted to style yourself on or anything like that?
We were massive fans of The Clash. We were big indie fans, so there was lots of kind of really obscure indie stuff that I loved. I mean, there was a band from Manchester called Big Flame that I absolutely adored when I was about 16, 17. They're an amazing band, but they were like an extreme noise, kind of like jazz, kind of improvisational indie guitar band. So they were a big inspiration to me, but there was lots of stuff. My mum used to play the Stones and Elvis, Frank Sinatra. There's so much stuff. I was just absolutely, I sang in choir, and I was just fascinated by music. So, by the time I got to 15, I was ready to actually want to make records myself or write songs myself by then.
Yeah. It's fascinating the route that people take into what they do and how they find their passions and get involved in them. I always find that really interesting. And of course, you know, there is a sad story at the centre of the band where you lost Richie Edwards in 1994, who just went missing and was never found. You kept going, of course, as a band. What was it that kept you going, do you think, and kept you together through what must have been just a horrendous time?
I think what kept us going after Richie's disappearance, very simply, was each other. Because Myself, Nick, Sean, and Richie, we all grew up in the same town, in the same valley in South Wales. We all went to the same school. We all had the same experiences, all went to the, you know, same rugby club discos. So kind of, you know, we didn't find each other through the back ads in The Enemy or Melody Maker. You know, we really did grow up with each other. And Sean is virtually my brother. We lived with each other since I was 10. So yeah, it was our shared history, our bond, our friendship. It was that, you know, it was that feeling of togetherness, some kind of brotherhood that got us over what happened with Richie. And I don't think you ever get over something like that, but
no.
it got us through it. It got us through to the other side.
Absolutely. Well, thank you for sharing that. So on the 2nd of October, you come into mighty Manchester, of course, and playing the Apollo. I mean, as a Mancunian, the Apollo's a really special one. I've seen, you know, bands and individuals, in whether that's comedy music or otherwise, you know, when they're in the beginning, really, where they've got pretty big, but they're at the beginning. And it's been so special to have that smaller venue before they go up to massive arenas, as, of course, you've played. I mean, is it nice for you to play those smaller, more intimate arenas sometimes compared to, you know, huge stadiums?
Oh, God. I mean, like, you know, for us, you know, playing this gig, we've played this gig before, and, you know, and we love this gig. And we've played many gigs in Manchester, you know, we've played the International, the Old Boardwalk, you know, the University, you know, the Arena. And this gig for us is just as good. And it still feels intimidating to me, this gig, actually, because it's quite an iconic gig. You know, so many played this gig. And, you know, it still feels quite big to me. I'm not deluded enough to think that, oh, this is quite small. No, it's big enough to still intimidate me. But it's nice going to a city and just walking past all the venues you've ever played there. That's a nice feeling. It makes you feel like you've got a connection with the city. And like I said, we've played to audiences of 100 in Manchester to, you know, to 10,000. So, like, we've had very, very rich and varied experiences in Manchester. All good, I've got to say.
I'm glad to hear it. I've just got a final question. When you were talking about nerves and, you know, sometimes there's those doubts that creep in. Are the things that you do that help with that? You know, is it certain, you know, maybe routine that you have before every gig or something like that you do to help with that at all?
I have a very, very simple way of getting over nerves, and I really, really just, I start screaming my head off. I start practicing. I start just really singing very loudly, and not even any songs. I just start singing lots of notes, and I kind of drowned out the doubts in my head. Whenever I'm feeling quite bad, I've got quite a good way of ignoring things, which I'm told is quite a special skill, but it just actually probably means that I'm probably not that bright, and I can just switch parts of my brain off.
I think that you can call it compartmentalizing. That makes it sound very sophisticated, but that's a great tactic.
Yes, I drowned out the noise, basically, with noise.
That's not a bad tactic at all, and it's obviously working because, you know, what incredible success you've had, and absolutely delighted that you come into Manchester in such a special venue as the Apollo as well. James, I've really loved chatting to you. Thanks so much for your honesty and openness and you know, sharing your inspirations and experiences with us, and really looking forward to the Manics being back in Manchester, and thanks so much for joining us on BBC Radio Manchester.
Cheers, Dave. Thank you.